بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
So what makes Arabic unique if you are a Muslim? It's not an ego massaging affair as Muslims, you know, like, but it's a fact of our religion, that our religion is the only religion that has a language that is a ritual language. Today, if you are a Muslim, you use the Fatiha at least 25 times every day, which is from the Quran. And so the Arabic language is very alive as a ritual language. And it is also a lingua franca among like parts of the human beings on the planet who use Arabic, whether they are native Arabic speakers or they are Muslims elsewhere in the world. So that's what makes Arabic unique. A lingua franca, for a long time, before the European rise in the 500 years ago, Arabic was like English today. There is a famous passage written by a Spanish priest. It's a passage that is widely much in the literature. You may come across it. Maybe you saw that already. If you read that passage made by a Catholic priest 400 years ago, wherever you see that passage, because the Muslim influence in Iberian Peninsula, wherever you read that passage about Arabs and Muslims, just put Americans, it fits today. Because it says our young people like to speak like them. They like to dress like them. They want to read their books. Just put American where you see Arab or Muslim today, that's the Americans. All these other kids, they wear Judas jeans from America. You see, they try to imitate Americans. You see what I'm saying? When you are a dominant culture, other people imitate you. Today, these people do rap in Chinese, in Korean, in Urdu, everywhere. Because that's the American influence. You see, when you are dominant, you have that influence. When the Arabic language was dominant as a lingua franca in the world, all the other human beings wanted to speak Arabic, because that was the place where you can get knowledge. Because all the books, the European foreign students in Spain used to hire a Jew who knew Arabic, and the Jew will translate it from Arabic to Spanish, and then you have Spanish who will translate from Spanish to Latin. That's how they got knowledge from the Muslims. Today you live in Berkeley. This is one of the best schools in the world today. I mean, you know, like, can you imagine if you are to have Chinese, they come here, they have to hire some other person to translate what is in English into Chinese. So you have an Hispanic will translate it, you know, into Spanish, but the Chinese, they know Spanish. Then they can translate from Hispanic to Chinese. That's how they got knowledge from the Muslims. Because when they came to the Muslims, this was Muslims control every knowledge in the world. That's not long ago. That's 600 years ago, 700 years ago. The Arabic was like English today in the world system. So we go back to the five zones I was telling you, that you have North Africa. The North Africans as people who go back to Pharaoh, they are from a Semitic language group. That was why it was easy. It took about 600 years since Islam entered Egypt before the Egyptians became Arabic speakers. So don't say that the Muslims just came and imposed Arabic on them. There are some Christian Egyptians who say, yeah, the Muslims came, they just forced Islam and Arabic on us. No, it took 600 years before they gradually became Arabic speakers in Egypt. It took a long time. The Muslims became politically dominant, but language was gradual. So you have Islamization and Arabization in North Africa. That's the difference between North Africa and the Muslim Arabic experience in North Africa from West Africa.
Applications for the 2009 Zaytuna Summer Arabic Intensive are now open. To apply, visit arabicintensive.org.